So then we flew to Los Angeles, and we were with our tape of God Is Love to mix it. We had 2 days off before like a 2 month American tour. And so we thought, well, we just went to mix it and see John and everything and finalize everything. And we get this message when we land, contact me immediately. And then he says, sorry guys, your song doesn't work. Can you write us a new one? The thing was, in typical Hollywood fashion, they put the movie out to a committee, you know, people...
Test audience, yes.
Basically. And the test audience all hated the end.
No. Specifically, the teenage girls
hated the ending.
Because the original ending, the Molly Ringwald's character, Andy, ends up with her best friend, Ducky. That was the original storyline. And of course, all the girls who went, no, he's her friend, he's great, but she's got the love stories with Andrew McCartney, the pretty boy. So they had to reshoot the end of the movie, and we had specifically been asked to do the song for the big ending where it resolves at the prom, and lyrically, our song didn't make sense.
You're right. We said, you've got to be kidding, right? All our equipment has gone to San Francisco for the start of the tour. We've got no gear. We've got 2 days, and you want us to write a new song?
It was really strange because, you know, we had always written on synthesizers and then we'd moved to computers, and we didn't have that stuff. We were waiting for it to arrive from the hire company, but we had a deadline. We had a day to get this thing nailed. So Paul and I sat down like old-fashioned songwriters, him at the piano and me standing next to him, and he's just banging out chords.
Never done this before.
It was like totally alien. You know, this is the way everybody else writes, but not us. And we tried and tried, and then the computer arrived, and our engineer was there because he was supposed to be mixing the other song. And we worked on it. We thought, well, this is working, it's okay. Finally, about 4 a.m,
we did a very rough demo.
We did a rough mix, put it on a cassette, sent it in a motorcycle to Paramount Studios, and we went to bed. And we remember, we're jet lagged as well. We'd only just landed, you know? And we were like, I'll do it. 9 o'clock in the morning, phone rings, manager. Yeah, John's hurt. It's great, can you go back and finish it? We're like, oh God. So we went back in and we did the saxophone overdubs and a few more things. But If You Leave, totally written, off the top of our heads, desperate, and the biggest hit in America. One of the other, you know, strange things really about doing it was that, you know, for us, we were having to write a song that fitted in a movie and in a scene that was actually alien to us, because we don't have proms in the UK. Yeah. We don't have an end of high school prom. So, and also, and I'll let you into a secret now, there's a line in the song that doesn't make sense, because kids in England, you go from your junior school to your high school at the age of 11, and you're there for 7 years. Not 4, you finish at 18. Whereas in the States, you've kind of got junior, middle and high kind of thing, and it's the last 4 years in high school. So 7 years went under the bridge is actually a reference to English high school that doesn't make sense in the US, actually.
7 years went under the bridge, like time standing still.
But because we had such little time, when we were at the writing stage at the piano and Andy writing the words, we had this verse and chorus, and we got the chord change into the chorus, but we could never get back to the verse chordally, and I tried all these different things, and we were running out of time, and in the end I said, just keep changing key, because if you keep changing key, you can get the...
That's why the song modulates up and down and all over. We were trying to fit the pieces together, and we didn't have time. It was just like, go up, go down, go,
you know. In hindsight, I mean, and when you listen to it now, you think, oh, that was all beautifully planned. But really, it was just getting out of a bit of a musical quandary.
And another thing, in the second verse, there's a little kind of like strange steel drum thing that goes diddle it, did it, diddle it, did it, did, which is a real hook. That was supposed to be landing on the downbeat of the chorus. He programmed it wrong, and it came in off time, and we went, oh, yeah. Oh, that's great, actually. So again, another accident that gave it that kind of...
There's a lot of happy accidents when you're writing songs. You know, you make mistakes that turn into a... It seemed like a great idea, but it was actually a happy accident.
So another couple of, you know, fun things that people might not know about it is we trimmed it down to 4:25. They said, we were amazed they wanted it as the lead single. We thought the Psychedelic First song would be the big one.
It seems to be the obvious one, Pretty in Pink, but, yeah. You know.
But so suddenly we had to kind of do... we had to get it ready, we had to do a single, we had to do a video. But they kept saying, nobody's going to play a song on radio that's longer than 4 minutes. And it's like, well, it's 5.5. So we were cutting and
couldn't find a place to cut because it ruined it every time we did it.
We finally got it down to 4:25, and we just couldn't find another place to edit. So these are the days before digital. So we just wrote on the box 4:01. And it's 4:25 long, and we just lied about how long it was.
We just lied on the label. And no one said anything. It got played on the radio. Yeah.
The only parameter is it's got to be 120 beats per minute, because we filmed them dancing at the prom to Don't You Forget About Me, which is that tempo. So we were like, okay, that's the only parameter. So we wrote If You Leave at the same tempo as the previous song, 120, and when it was finally accepted, we went to the Hollywood program. We were all in the limos, red carpet, Chinese man's theatre. Of course, we're right at the end, so we're sat there kind of like, going, yeah, the music's great, but come on, get to our bit, you know. And we finally get to the prom scene. Oh, and we went, hang on a minute, who edited this? Nobody's dancing on the beat. The tempo doesn't matter, and for 5 minutes everybody's dancing off the beat. We're like,
I don't think fix that in the end.
The other great thing about having If You Leave in our back pocket when we're in America is it's like playing poker, and you know you've got four aces, because when that drum fill comes in at the front, it's just like going,
people go nuts,
there you go, win in hand. Crowd go crazy. It is, it's like sitting there with four aces in your hand. It's great. Some people get stupid about their big hit and they go, oh, I'm so bored of it, I played it thousands of times.
And they don't play it live, or they play a boring acoustic version of it to be different live.
Why?
We're proud of our hits.
That is awesome.
You know. We're proud of our hits.
That song has been good to you, so treat it with respect, and also treat the audience with respect. It's part of their journey of life, their memory, so don't screw around with it. Well, the success of If You Leave certainly opened doors for us. Strangely enough, in all of the countries where we hadn't had much success previously, obviously the US, Australia, places like that, South Africa, and yet, it seemed to close doors in places where we'd been successful previously. For example, If You Leave didn't even make the top 50 in the UK.
Isn't that odd?
Yeah, it's very odd.
So it's, but you know what? When you're driving around LA and on comes your song on the radio and you go, oh, comedy boredom, I'll change the channel. Oh, it's on another station. Oh, it's on another, that's when you know you've cracked it.
Exactly.